to this. It's like, oh God, I've got a cable, and I'm sitting on the cable. I mean, you know, it takes a little practice, huh? As I said, we have remarkable, remarkable people in the room, and I'm talking about all of you, and the incredible six people who are here as our guests, who are giving their time during National Dance Week. And National Dance Day is Saturday, correct? Okay, so it's all of a moment. I'm gonna introduce them very briefly now, and then I have sort of specific kinds of questions to ask them, but really what I would like is I'm gonna ask you to talk sort of, I'm gonna put you in pairs and get you going in certain ways, okay? You ready, Toni?
I cannot even find the keys to my car.
That's good. This is Toni Basil, and yes! There are so many reasons to love and admire her. As you know, I mean, we all know about Mickey, right? I mean, that's just the most incredible thing. And but she, I think what is most remarkable really is that you have always, first of all, you always have evolved, you have always connected to the street, to the underground, you have put your ear on the earth to hear how people are dancing, and you pick it up and you keep going and evolving forms, merging you know, what you've done with street dance and ballet. You were the first at that. I mean, really early MTV work. So much of what has happened in dance in America has to do with what you have done and who you are. And I thank you.
Thank you. We can't leave out the word the lockers.
We cannot leave out the word the lockers. Do you want to tell them why quickly?
Well, I think the lockers were truly the first street dance group that got on television and were actually paid. They weren't just on, we weren't just on Soul Train. And we were unique because we were a group of dancers that did not have to dance behind a singer. As in So You Think You Can Dance, it's not about a singer, it's about the dancers. Dancing with the Stars, it's about the dancer. And I think it's shown all of America, and of course internationally, the power of dance. And we are so grateful for your show, for everything that you've done, and getting it out there. Oh my God.
Oh my God. And away we go. I'm going to quickly, now I said quickly I was going to introduce you. Tina Landon. Tina Landon also, to, would you wave so they all know if they don't know who you are? All right, great. And you know, she grew up in Los Angeles. She knows Los Angeles. She's seen Los Angeles evolve also and has been a huge part of that, working with Paula Abdul-Castor for Janet Jackson's What Have You Done For Me Lately music video. And during her Rhythm Nation tour, she also choreographed Janet's music video for If and her Velvet Rope tour. She's a five-time MTV Choreography Award nominee. And has worked with Michael and Janet Jackson Scream and for Ricky Martin's Live in La Vida Loca. Also is a teacher and, as you'll hear later, has one of the results for DanceMapLA talks about aesthetics and how people are learning to look at dance. And I look forward to what you're saying about aesthetics and the way things are informed now. Nigel Lithgow is to her left. Nigel Lithgow. I feel that, and I think probably many, this is nothing new in the room, but I know for a fact that as a writer of dance, many people do not know the word choreographer. It's just so strange to me. And you changed that. Yeah. You dignified choreographers. You made it an American word that comes out of the mouths of everybody as they think and they breathe. And that has also given us dance in the center of our lives. And to watch those dancers learn from three different people and to see the speed with which now dancers pick up technique is so much.
Some dancers.
And we will be talking about that. Nigel, as you may know, is the founder of Dizzy Feet Foundation, really important foundation having to do with education. The executive producer of So You Think You Can Dance, in case there's anybody in the room who does not know that. He established Dizzy Feet, and in 2010 created National Dance Day. So again, which is coming up on this Saturday. So we are really honored you're here. I don't know how you're doing this, but you're incredible. All right, would you like to introduce yourself? This is Lil Caesar. Now, it says right here, an original B-boy dance pioneer. And you know, I can read these things, and I always feel really funny kind of reading people's bios, because the fact of the matter is, we walked into the green room, and you were surrounded instantly by Nigel and by Toni, just shaking your hand and talking about you and your dancing and what it means and what you've done, what it does mean to be an original B-boy. And that's the kind of thing that I think in dance is so wonderful, when you see that kind of connection of gratitude for you and what you've done. Lil Caesar created a school called the Hip Hop Dance Academy, and it's in Pomona with his wife, Norma, who's here, Umana. And he's going to talk about that, because it was doing very well, and it folded recently. So in part of the conversation, not to be so completely upbeat, as we know, things are not all good news, much as we would like it to be. So he's going to talk about that. Lula Washington. Lula Washington has had a company in Los Angeles and a school for 35 years. Today, Susie Jerry, who you met earlier, ran us through a couple of exercises as a group. It was one of those things where you kind of go, oh God, do I have to do it? And then you do it, and it becomes one of those transformative moments in which she asked everyone to go from how long they've been in LA starting this month to 20, 30 years and on out the door, practically. We wound up in a lump and of people who've been here for 30, 40 years. She then said, put your hand on the person you've known the oldest, the longest. The person, your hand on the shoulder of the person you've known the longest. And radiating off of Lula's body were 7 or 8 or 9 hands of everyone in the room across the generations. And what was so incredible was actually to see that, because one person who decides to start a school and who can hang on to it and a company and who perseveres like that, it is a ripple. It takes courage, it takes so much work and so much faith, and you have transformed and changed Los Angeles and our lives. She also had choreographed Avatar and The Little Mermaid, so she does both stage and as Doug was saying, we don't know what language to use. I promise I'm going to stop talking in a moment, but first I have to get to Laura Zucker. Thank you. Laura Zucker. Laura Zucker is the executive director of the Los Angeles County Arts Commission. She's been doing that for 23 years. She is there. Talk about being in the trench. She is fighting for the arts, for artists, for us, for 23 years. She knows policy. She has the County Arts Commission, in case you didn't know, LA County is the largest county in the country, right? It funds 380 nonprofit organizations through a $4.5 million grant program. We're talking about leadership and people who know or who care and who know what to do and have something to do it with. Implements Arts for All is an organization she started, and she's going to talk about that. It is very concerned with education and arts for all, and she's going to, she has some ideas. It's restoring arts education to the schools. This is essential, right? She also, all the programming, everything you see at the John Anson Ford Theater, That's her, that's what she runs. So free, not all free, but you know, that, but putting performance in there, again, the capacity to see live dance. These are our bodies. You've got to see it live sometimes, right? So thank you, Laura. Now that I have you, what I really want to say is I want to ask Nigel and Laura to have a kind of conversation about, because Nigel, I know that you, we have this moment right here, right now, where if things are broken, we can fix them. If there's something that we can do and that you really want to do it, we have soldiers in the room who want to take leadership roles. With is yours not working? With Dizzy Feet Foundation. I know you care about technique. I know you believe that the reason Nigel got so behind DanceMapLA and gave us, took us into So You Think You Can Dance and gave us a platform to tell the dancers about it was a remarkable support. And you did it because of the stories that the dancers tell and because dance transforms lives. And you're determined through Dizzy Feet to get this into the schools and to keep transforming lives. How can we all help you? What do you need? And Laura, you're working with Arts for All, and this is an opportunity, again, to hear, let's talk about, if the two of you could talk about what you do and how you do it and how we might do it together, possibly.
I'm not sure if I'm coming from the angle you want me to come from, because I don't believe everybody can be a professional dancer. But I do believe everybody needs dance in their lives. And I think it is an incredible area that we're just learning from the neuroscientists now exactly what dance can do throughout our lives, not just as young kids, but as we get older as well. So I'm just trying to make sure that dance is provided to everybody. I think it's a right. I think it's also, and you can tell me better than I know, you know, being a visitor to your country, that California, in the actual school curriculum, states that dance should be taught in schools. And if a school isn't doing that, then it's illegal.
Well, yes, technically
that's... It's a core subject.
That is true. And there's actually someone trying to sue the State Department of Education in order to force that issue. It is in the code that actually all four disciplines should be taught in every school.
It's also, I think, a problem that here... In this state, you need more than one credential. You can't just be a dance teacher, can you?
No, you can be credentialed if you're a musician in music and if you're a visual artist in visual arts. But if you want to teach dance, you have to be credentialed in physical education. And if you want to teach theater, you have to be credentialed in English. And there has been a fight on for several decades in the state of California to change this. Not successfully, because it's opposed by the teachers' union, which is opposed to the addition of credentials. But I have an idea of a way around that.
Okay.
Are you all sitting comfortably? Soup and blankets will be provided at the end of the evening.
Well, physical education is different than any other subject matter requirement in the state of California because it's actually a time requirement. 100 minutes of physical education has to be taught in the schools every 2 weeks. Why don't we grab a certain amount of those minutes and say that they have to be dance? Mm-hmm. Why not? Dance is taught, but it's discretionary. What if we said, half, 50 of the 100 minutes have to be dance. In one fell swoop, everybody who's trained in physical education would have to be trained to teach dance, and people who know to teach dance would be much easier for them to get a credential in physical education. I think we should do it.
See, if I may add to that, I don't think that we should just separate dance. I think dance should be included within the actual curriculum. I'll give you a quick story, and then I'm going to ask you a question, and I promise you, I think everyone in the entire room will get the question right. Johns Hopkins University split a class in half, and they were talking about the planetary system. And half of the class, they gave slides and books, textbooks and everything to learn. The other half, they said, who's the littlest kid in the room? Okay, you're the planet Mercury. Who's the biggest kid in the room? Okay, you are Jupiter. You're the biggest planet. You're Earth. Gave a little girl a miner's helmet with a lamp on. You're the sun because you're shining the light. And everyone else wandered around and with little silver hats to reflect the sun's light. So you get in the picture. So now they're all in their little circles, put some music on, and they all danced around the sun. The next day, they asked both halves of the class, tell us about the planetary system, which is the largest planet. Oh, that was Malcolm. He's the big fat one. Oh, yeah, that was... he was Jupiter. Who was? What's the smallest planet? Oh, that was little Ian. That's he was Mercury. Which half of the class do you think got 98% of the questions right? The dancers. Absolutely. So it isn't just a question of, oh, this is how you dance and you do your bar. It's about using your body and learning. The same way as I remember every Beatles lyric because I used to sing them and it goes into that side of the brain. And I can't remember half the people I met yesterday or their names.
So I am in complete agreement that arts education is in fact a social justice issue that everyone is entitled to. And I'm also in complete agreement that it has to be a combination of being taught as a special skill and integrated into the curriculum. No question. Because we are fundamentally dealing with a vicious circle here. Of the four disciplines, art, music, theater, and dance, dance is by far the least taught in either of these methodologies in any of our school districts. And we need to change this paradigm and catapult it to the front of the curriculum, because fewer people who experience dance and learn it in their muscle memory go to see it and experience it as adults or continue to engage in it as adults, which means that there are fewer audiences, which means that they're harder for you to reach, which means that there's fewer paying customers, which means there's less money to be made, which means that there's less money to pay dancers. And until we break this paradigm through arts education, we won't move ourselves out of this circle.
And the education system is lacking that at this moment in time. America is something like 25th in the world, 32nd in math. It's just wrong, and no one is standing up and owning up and saying we've got our education system wrong. We are not finding what we're good at. We're telling people you've got to do this, regurgitate these facts, put them on a piece of paper. We're not finding out what makes a better human being. And at the end of the day, all the jobs are going to disappear because machines are going to get our jobs. What the thing that machines can't do is be creative. And we're not teaching creativity at the moment. And the first thing when you come out of college and university now isn't the degree, it's how creative are you? That's the first question that people are asked when they're coming out of uni.
And
how
so,
creative.
Sorry, I didn't mean to jump on the end of your statement because it was so important, but I just wanted to add as maybe one last thought on this subject that there is something that everybody here can do about it. Arts for LA is our regional advocacy organization for arts education. You can sign up on the site. It's free to be a member. You can get direct postings on everybody running for school board in the district that you live in. You can go to candidate forums. You can communicate with school board members because there's 81 school districts in Los Angeles County. And unless you speak up and are active in your public school district, this is something that you can do today that will continue to keep things moving forward in LA County, because the good news is there's a hell of a lot more arts education in Los Angeles County schools now than there were 15 years ago before the regional blueprint for arts education began, and you can keep that momentum going.
Thanks to outside organizations.
That's terrific. So we now have a to-do item. Very important. Very important to leave here with something to do, right? Arts for LA. Sophia Klatsker was in the audience, and Charles Flowers is here. He's raising his hand. He's the new director?
Deputy
director, and Sophia Klatsker, who was here earlier. So put him in your sights, and he will tell you more about that. Lula and Lil Caesar.
Oh, I knew it was the deputy.
Both of you, I see you actually nodding during that conversation, and I'm not sure why you were nodding, but one thing you both have in common is that you run schools and you know, have for a long time, and so the subject was education in that way. What happened, Little Caesar, that this school failed? What if you now could say, here, look, if you're going to do this, this is what's going on now in this time, in this day and age that I need, and how can we all help you?
Well, good evening, everybody. But first and foremost, I was nodding because this is one of the reasons we started the Hip Hop School of Arts. You know, we developed curriculums, syllabus, which was a huge challenge in the hip hop culture because it's never been done in the world, in hip hop. So when they're speaking about arts and education, that's one thing that is in our mission statement. And that's one of the reasons, you know, we actually so committed to the importance of the school. I think one of the things that was missing in the school was continuously actually connect to the funding resources and also bring grant writers, so paying grant writers as well, and also in the marketing aspect as well, and also bring funding for staff. You know, we have so many volunteers, but it only goes to a certain level where they say, okay, I can't do this no more. You know, so I think, you know, the fact that we had X amount of dollars to made it last for 9 years, you know, it took about 5.5 years, and it took about 3 years, a little bit over 3 years that we existed. And, you know, so I think the funding was a huge fundamental to actually paying the instructors as well as some of the, a few staff that is fundamental, required, so they wouldn't leave. You know, because we were there, you know, volunteering basically, because we knew the importance of providing a service to the community. I mean, you know, in Pomona, we had like 50% dropout rate from high school. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a 28%, you know, low income families. And we understood that aspect, and that's what we went to Pomona. It's not so much different out here in LA as well. I mean, I grew up out here in LA, so I kind of made a study on the statistics as well. But I know that Pomona is a smaller city, and it costs less. It costs us about $1.2 million to develop over there, and over here would have cost about $5 million. So, but, you know, going back to what you ask, is really the next step of funding to maintain the facility, you know, alive.
And Lula, do you when you're hearing this, what do you want to say to him? What's your experience having now for 35 years done this in Los Angeles? And what advice or thoughts do you have to him?
Well, I started with nothing. And so, and started with nothing, that meant that I had to figure out how to make it work with nothing. So I guess where you start will determine how much support you're going to get and how well you reach out to the surrounding communities that you are embedded in. When I say reach out, I'm talking about to the parents, their grandparents, all of the kids, making them your ambassadors as well, going to PTA meetings. I literally stood on the corner at the school across from my studio to pass out flyers to students and to talk to their parents about what we were doing. Making connections with teachers. And yeah, you gotta have the grant writers, but at first you gotta bring them in to see what you're doing all the time, even if it's like one student dancing at first. And you talk about your vision and you talk about your dream and you talk about the value of it to your community, your environment that you're in. And then you have the kids tell their stories about what it means to them. Because they're the ones that will help to generate funding for what you're doing, which is a very important cause to have that type of studio. And it's very much needed in communities such as ours, such as where you are, because it gives the students something to do that's very positive and keeps them off the street. And down the road, it also keeps them in school, because once they get that, they get a good feeling of achieving something, even if it's walking across the floor and doing your hip-hop step or whatever it is. And it's uplifting them as well. So it's a hard journey, but it's a journey that can be possible, can be a reality. Now, you started, you're talking about $5 million and all this. Oh, God, I wish I would have had that to start out with. My God. But, you know, you're at a different point in time, you know. And my training was in school. They didn't teach us that. And I didn't come from, I started from a very humble beginning, just a vision and a dream about what I wanted to do. And worked diligently at trying to make that happen. And along the way, inspiring students. It started with 3 students, then I got 5, then I got 10, and then I got the parents who really got, oh, this is really good for my child. She's doing better in school. She can count better. I had the teachers across the street come over. Oh, you know what? They're counting better because they're taking dance class now. Oh, let me try to talk that principal into letting me send more kids. Even having teachers go into their pockets to send money over so we can make classes available for students. So my grandmother used to say, where there's a will, there's a way. And so, you know, I'm from old school, so I keep that in the back of my mind when something's not going well. But when you persevere and you go back at it again, because you'll be fortified, you know, you got some people in here that can help you out. You sitting next to one right there, you know. Okay, but wait. I can't let you just hug him. I got to hug him, too. Okay, so, and then there's this lady right here. So, you know, it's about getting your feet wet and knowing how to, you know, dry off and keep going.
Can I jump in and just say that we've just done Willy Wonka down at Martin Luther King's elementary school. And all of a sudden, there's a huge attendance in the school. And the kids are going to school and the parents. And that's really important, you were saying, Lula. Yeah. The parents are interested. Yeah. And getting the parents interested was because their kids were in a show. Singing and dancing. Mm-hmm. And as soon as the parents are involved, it changes the whole thing. Mm-hmm. They become proud of their kids. Their kids are proud that their parents are proud of them. Mm-hmm.
So that's why my personal belief is you started with them at 3. You may not want to, but you should. Seriously. Because those are the ones that will help you generate a base. I'm serious. A financial
that.
Base.
You'll love that. You're gonna
no, find
it
somebody that will help. Find somebody that will help you with it. There's always someone that will want to put the music on and help them enjoy movement. And while they're moving, they're learning how to count. Yeah. They're learning their directions. They're learning which way is the right, which way is the left. They're learning lots of different things that they will continue to build upon. But you know, when you motivate them, they don't want to come back. And that I have little bitty kids, this year old. I'm so glad I'm in dance class. I said, why? She said, it's so much fun. And the mother, she won't let me rest. I have to come every single, do you have classes on Sunday? No, we don't have classes on Sunday. My daughter wants to come to class, you know? So that's the kind of motivation and passion that we as a field have to plant into the students. So 3 years old, you gotta wait a long time for the benefit, but you think you keep them 3 years old. You keep them at 3, by the time they're 15, they're still there.
You know, I'm just going to add that 98% of parents in this country want arts education for their children. There's no argument about it. We have the people who believe in it. They just, like us, are frustrated about how do we get there, and we can help them get there. We've got a huge base that can be mobilized. These are the same folks, you know, when they send their kids to private school. Private schools have great arts education because parents vote with their checkbooks in that case. It's children in public school who deserve the same.
You know, I was told that 135,000 kids in this country take a gun to school every day.
Oh.
135,000.
Whoa.
Imagine if that was a pair of tap shoes or a script or a musical instrument. That would be wonderful.
You know, I'm been working on forever this book on the history of American street dance or conversations with my friends. And I've asked everyone the same question, what would you be doing, because they're all street dancers, if you weren't dancing? And they, all of them, except for one, said, I'd be either in jail or dead. every single one of them, except Anthony Thomas, who was one of the choreographers of Rhythm Nation also, said he would be a chef. Everybody, because the street really comes out of the projects. It comes out of, you know, life. It comes out of improvisation. And it has, all over the world, there are just kids that they want to dance like Pop and Pete more than they want to dance like Brezhnikov. Mm-hmm. But it has saved so many lives, mm-hmm. as you know. So many lives. So,
I mean, I could, you know, for me, you know, I was born in El Salvador. I grew up in, you know, about 3 or 4 years of the war in the early, late 70s to the, you know, 1981. But when I came out here, I MacArthur Park area, 7th and Union, you know, Alvarado, it wasn't the best neighborhood. I mean, it's so easy to get involved in gangs because that's all you're surrounded by. But like you said earlier, you know, dance really saved my life. Literally, if it wasn't for this beautiful art form called hip-hop, I don't think I'd be sitting right next to this dude right here, you know, and everyone over here, you know. So
gangs, they're just Beverly Hills housewives.
So most definitely, dance is just a, you know, it really transformed. I think it just gave me an opportunity, and it gave me something to do, you know, and get creative, and I just fell in love with it, and I'm so glad that I continue pushing forward. You know, I went to the probably the worst unified district high school out here, you know, where you had metal detectors, you know, where guns were coming in. I mean, the security guards were scared of the students. Yeah. You know, so it was pretty terrifying.
I've auditioned like 500,000 kids in this country, whether it was with American Idol or So You Think You Can Dance, and we get these little bios, their backstories, and they're horrific. Mm-hmm. To read them, they are horrific. You know, the guns, the violence, the addictions, everything else, it's just horrible.
I wanted to, sort of off of that, Tina talked to me earlier about something that she was really concerned about. Both of you, both Tina and Toni, you talked to me about training and teaching and homework, and Tina talked about the sexualization of dance. And I'm going here because the aesthetics of dance also matter. And what you're seeing with this next generation had you both pretty concerned you said, who survives? It really interests me who survives. You've got to do your homework. You've got to come into auditions knowing what you're doing. You're seeing that these kids can do, now they can pick up faster. They only need to do half of a chasse and a quarter of a, you know, they get it much faster. At the same time, you, Tina, said that you're having to tone down kids so that they're not, what do you mean by that? And what is happening aesthetically in this art form? And could you two have a conversation about that? Because it relates to training and everything.
Yeah, one of the things that that we spoke about that is really dear to my heart, and I've been teaching a lot more. I took a long break from doing choreography. I was completely wiped out with all the crazy pop stars. They wore me down. And so I just took a moment, and I really concentrated on my acting. And then I came back, and I had come to this forum the last 2 years that you guys had it. And I sat right there on the couch, and I kind of listened, because I thought I was the only one. I thought I was going crazy. I thought, am I just getting old, and I don't get this new generation? But they aren't learning. What are they learning? They're learning to do 1,000 eight counts in class, but they're not learning the skill or the technique to actually elongate their careers, to actually have careers. It's so much more than just how much choreography can I learn, right? It was really scary for me standing outside of a classroom getting ready to go in and hearing really explicit language, which that's just never been a part of any organization I've been in, whether it's been a convention or a studio or my own upbringing. I would never use explicit language music for any of my students, let alone when I looked in, there was a couple of 11 and 12 year olds in there. And this is way more common than I think a lot of people know, especially here in Los Angeles. And it just lit this fire in me. I thought, are you not, as a choreographer, a teacher, an educator, what is it that you're teaching when you are bringing this type of music? And not only that, when you're not looking at your students and seeing what they're eating up the language, but unfortunately, the young girls are eating up the movement and the objectification of themselves without even being knowledgeable about that. So I've had to tone down, you know, it's, you know, they're not doing sugars and, you know, little things anymore. They're actually, unfortunately, on the ground and they're humping it. And they're 11 and 12, and that's even the older generation of these young groups. And I've had a long conversation with Leslie Scott, with the youth, with YPAD, youth protection advocates in dance, because this is such a critical time. Mm-hmm. And it also, so it really kind of made me dive into a lot of, is it just me? Is it just a few choreographers? Is it just a few teachers? And why is this happening? Why are we allowing this to happen in our dance studios? Why are we allowing it to happen at dance conventions? Why are little girls showing up in lingerie and going home with trophies? I don't understand this. And it's really, and then on top of all of that, where are the Sinead turns? Where are the tendus? Where are the jetés across the floor? Nobody's teaching that anymore, unless you're fortunate enough to be at, you know, LMU or Irvine or at the colleges, but then there's a whole separation there. And I loved when we guys talked about earlier that even though I thought dance was a universal language, there's a lot of separation in it. And so I have a lot of friends that teach at LMU. They teach at all the universities where they're very, it's very heavy contemporary, very heavy modern. Apparently what I do is now called commercial dance, which is, I guess, the category I'm in. And that's fine. That's what it is. It's tours and music videos and television shows. But there's a big separation, too, there in what is being taught. And my fear is that we are producing a generation of choreographers, teachers, and educators that are not actually doing the job of teachers and educators.
Well, that's what's on videos. Yeah. Those children are doing what they see on videos. And hey, I remember, you know, being in a class, taking Popping Taco, one of the great street dancers of all time, to a class. Let's see, how do I say it without saying the name? And to educate some jazz, to educate a lot of dancers, street dancers, that they had to be able to communicate out there. So I would take people to jazz classes because I was taking jazz class and street dancing and whatever. And I was brought him to a class, and he was popping, you know, on the side because he wanted to show off. And the teacher said, "There'll be none of that in my school." Now, that school, it's got to be either Edge Millennium or Debbie Reynolds or Debbie Allen's or Lula's, but it wasn't Lula's. That's all they have is now street. So things change and evolve, you know. We had a hard time with the lockers trying to get that kind of dance on television as an art form. Look, I walked into that, to these clubs, and I would see art that I could go to ABT, see Brezhnikov do a solo, do Don Q, and I could go later on to a club and see Don Campbell entertain me and do technique and creating on the spot. And I went, God, this has got to go on. They've got to be able to earn a living. Previous to that, I was involved in street, in films, and I probably had a career in the beginning because I was trained and I loved go-go dancing and I was a cheerleader. And there's two people sitting right here, Anita Mann and Leslie Evans, who also came from that time period. And we probably, with 20 other people, existed in every beach movie, every TV shindig show, because we could translate street at that time, which was go-go dance, count it, and we were educated in dance. And I've had a career because I'm eclectic. Because I probably, you know, I mean, I might be choreographing Bette Midler, but she doesn't always go out on the road. And I might be choreographing or working with street dancers. That always doesn't exist. I've had to be eclectic. I could not earn a living without being eclectic. But I was lucky. I started out. My parents were in show business. I stood on the side of the stage since I was 5 years old. And I've seen everybody from Sammy Davis Jr. when he was dancing with his uncles, to the Zonies, to these opening acts that did all sorts of, you know, adagio. And I saw Eartha Kitt writhing in... What was a great, great play she did that she sang Santa Baby on a couch? I'll never forget that. But my mother also took me to see Jamer and Roland Petit. You know? So I saw so much. Oh, Zizi Jamer and Roland Petit, who were also cutting edge, were very cutting edge. So I've had an education not because I've tried, but because dance is my drug. And no one will survive in the dance community if they are not driven to dance, period. Not to earn money, not to do anything, but just to dance. And that's what kind of street was about. These were the kids that were great dancers that their mothers did not take them to a dance class. They were driven to dance. Driven to create. That's how you got locking, that's how you got popping, that's how you got b-boys, that's how you got hip-hop, that's how you got crumping. It comes out of this passion. So yes, there should be dance in everybody's life, but as Nigel said, everybody's not going to be a dancer, because you can't go out there thinking, I'm going to earn a living, because we all know you can't earn a living out there. You know, as a choreographer or a dancer. So it is education, and it is, but it really takes a passion. It just takes passion.
Can I say one thing, since you talked about us having soldiers out here and then people can spread the word? Yeah. You know, I don't want to just be up here complaining about the things that I'm seeing. I'd like to offer some type of suggestion as to maybe, you know, making studio owners accountable, and rather than just having a disclaimer that, hey, your daughter might hear some foul language in a class or she might be asked to perform, we are, you know, we're not responsible, is to actually have some rules of etiquette at these studios, in your classes, at the conventions, and make people accountable to just a moral compass.
I don't know if you can do it. I mean, I see people, you know, in the salsa community or in the Lindy community. They study salsa or Lindy for a year, and they open up a school. And then the Lindsay, you know, when they're partnering, Lindy is dangerous. They throw everybody up in the air. They catch. And these people are partnering without any training.
Right. New York Times advertises for dance teachers for the Fred Astaire School. No experience necessary. It's how they advertise. One thing I'd like to say, and the reason we started So You Think You Could Dance at 18 was exactly what you're saying. We didn't want honey boo-boos wandering around.
Right.
But I will take the blame for something, and it's I'm not going to apologize for it, because I think, you know, So You Think You Could Dance has done so much good for the community, but we've also done a bit of bad as well, and that is, what is contemporary? Will someone really tell me? Because the kids that say I'm a contemporary dancer don't know what the hell they're talking about. You know, contemporary in my world was always a ballet based. It was always from ballet, and then it was all. Then it became modern ballet, and then it became from modern ballet contemporary. These kids don't do ballet now, and they say, I'm a contemporary dancer. And they're reaching into the ether with a look like... and they think that's contemporary dancing. I mean, my God. It used to be called hemorrhoids in my day. So, you know, we've done this, and because of the very nature of the program we are, we do minute and a half routines. And we go through a spectrum of emotions in that minute and a half. And people are following that rather than looking at what actually Mia Michaels is saying with that sunflower or what Thais D'Iorio meant when the woman raged against her husband's breast when she had cancer. There are, you know, there's a lot more behind that than just putting a dance routine together where you do a quick jeté, roll over on your bum and reach out into the ether. and they're copying the wrong things. And that's the problem, I think, with So You Think You Can Dance.
Just a quick tag on. Just a lot of things have to do with how we're prepared. And when we see a lot of the new teachers coming up, particularly what, for instance, what I do, I require an audition to see how they teach. And the minute I walk by that room and I see that they're giving my kids knee slides and stuff like that, I have to say, stop the music for a second, and you come over here so I could talk to you. Do you understand that these are beginners? But the problem is they have no concept. They don't know how to teach. So the thing for those of us that do know how to teach is to keep drumming that concept, is that you have to learn how to teach. If you don't know how to teach, go to someone and ask them, please help me how to teach. Because even in schools, I'm sorry, they're not teaching you how to teach. I've had people that come from schools with degrees, they do not know how to teach. And they don't know how to communicate with the students. They don't talk the same, they don't even speak the terminology. You know, and that's very disturbing to me. And so how do you find the good teachers? They're rare. They're rare. And that's why people say, well, I have a resume and I did all this, this, this. And I said, so that's nice, but I don't know you. I don't know if you really know how to teach or not. And just so what? You came from so-and-so's company? That don't mean anything. You still don't know how to teach, do you? I mean, I will watch you and then I will decide if you can teach here. If you have, are you going to teach my students correctly? Because you can tell right in a, just by watching 5 minutes, if they know what they're doing or not. And so I try to develop a system to train teachers or my dancers and people how to teach. And so I hope that this method crosses over and it's something that they can take with them, which I think some of them have taken with them, so they know that there is a process to warming up the body. There's a way that you start to teach a class. There's a way that you prepare the students to so that they can progress. So you can.
But this
see
is
that
right
growth.
Across our society. This yeah. isn't just dance. This is across our entire society. Somehow, somewhere along the line, and I'll speak for my own country, teachers became teachers because they failed at doing something else. And I know it's a terrible generalization, but that's what happened. They wanted to be something else and they didn't quite make it. Well, I'm going to teach. The same with us. When we audition kids here and we say, what are you doing? Oh, I'm a teacher. And they're terrible. They're terrible dancers. It doesn't mean to say you've got to be a great dancer to be a great teacher, I add very quickly. But this is the whole thing that's going across our society. We should be paying teachers an absolute fortune. That is who is creating the next society. And we somehow ignore it.
Can I jump on that for a second?
We actually have a hole in the arts ecology in this. You know, one of the interesting things about the survey that was just done, it reinforced the fact that teaching across all disciplines, including dance, is the greatest secondary source of income for artists. No matter if they're musicians, theater people, dancers, it's the greatest secondary source of income. But there is no place to go in Los Angeles for an artist to be trained to teach. Now, the Arts Commission actually tried to fill this gap for several years. We ran a training program for artists who wanted to teach in schools, who didn't, you know, necessarily want to get a teaching credential, who were going to be hired by schools to supplement what the teachers were doing. And we were able to do it for several years, and then it kind of, the funding. But we need to really look at this, because there needs to be a place where dancers who want to work in schools and who want to work with young people, who want to work in studios, but don't want to go back for 2 years of graduate school, can learn from people like Lula how to scaffold skills and knowledge.
I'd just like to jump on that, because I wish there were more studio owners and teachers that felt the way you did, and we wouldn't have this problem. But I would say that one of the other really driving forces as to why we have so many teachers that can't teach is because lovely social media, as lovely as it is, the classes have become more of a self-promoting stage than it does an education stage. So what happens is whoever gets the most amount of hits on YouTube, right, the studio owner in Iowa goes, hey, that person's got X amount of hits, I'm going to bring them to my studio. Or somebody who's been on So You Think You Can Dance, they're an amazing dancer, and they've got an amazing amount of followers. It doesn't make them a teacher, but yet they're getting hired at such incredible salaries that it's everything is very disproportionate in what's happening in the teaching world of dance. And I hope we can fill that gap. And I hope we can
need to figure out a way to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think also we need a lot more leadership, basic, you know, people that really want to take this on to really empower and continue to certify dancers, you know, because that's, you know, the Hip Hop School of Arts, that's one of the also things that we run into.
USA.
And same thing like you, you know, I had over 30 years of experience, you know, in b-boying, and when someone is trying to get in their head and trying to spin right away, they had no experience, you know, you really got to know what you're doing, you know, because could easily injure yourself and not even, you know, break your neck.
Is that why it was called breakdancing originally?
Well, I'll tell you why it was called breakdancing. You know, like our parents, our moms and dads, when they get mad, they throw pans at us and we go, whoa, whoa, whoa. And then we land on the floors and all of a sudden we start breaking and we land on the freeze, you know. We're running for our lives. Now your mom is breaking on me, man.
We have audience questions here, which they've written down. And so I'm going to ask the very first one. This is from Angela Johnson Peters. She asks it to all of you, anyone who wants to answer. How do we use people's interest in dance generated from shows such as So You Think You Can Dance and Dancing with the Stars to support and connect with arts advocacy efforts, arts education, and promoting the value of dance? Essentially, I think she's saying, how can we get something connected here out of this panel?
How do we leverage your audience?
It's you've got to get to the politicians. There are so many. You know, you're right with Los Angeles and California. We have got so many organizations for after schools enrichment and, you know, turnaround arts, LA's best. But everyone's doing their best. Mm-hmm. And this is without question the best time while we have these programs on. And I don't know if we'll be back next year of Dancing with the Stars will, and it'll disappear again on television. Dance will just disappear. And then I'm frightened about what's going to happen. Yeah. But we have to get to the politicians. They're the ones that change it. And they're the ones that haven't had an arts education at the moment. And that's a problem, because they don't realize how important the arts are to us all.
Well, some of them, well, let me just say this real quick. Okay. So what you said about the politicians is exactly correct. And the problem is that we will say that today, but then when the call comes to go, who gets on the bus to go? So either you're going to do writing letters campaign, get to know your, Arwanda Lewis, who I used to dance with, she would always say, I have to go downtown and get me some money. And she would leave us at the studio in rehearsal. And I didn't understand that for a long time. And she would always say, I have to go downtown and get me some money. And then after I started my own dance company and for years did not get any funding, I realized, okay, I have to do something. And I was pushed to do it. And so I said, I made an appointment and I went down to my city councilman and made an appointment to go in and talk to him. And I went in the office and I said, I have a dance company and we're sa-da-da-da-da-da-da-dee-da-da-da-da. And I've been trying to get funding from the city cultural affairs, and that you wasn't there then. But
that was the city, not the county.
City, not the county. Okay. And I said, I'm wondering what it is, why I don't get any funding. And I'll never forget it. He put his arm around me and he pointed his toe and he said, I used to dance. And I said, oh, really? And who did you dance with? Catherine Dunham.
Wow.
I said, well, have you been getting anything that I've been sending to your office? And he said, well, you know the other things. I said, no, but you need to know that the arts are important too. And at that point was when I started to get some type of recognition and funding. Everything has to do with politics. We as artists don't want to accept that, but it's a reality. Why do you think now the LA Arts for LA, why do we have advocacy? Because we know now that we have to jump up and down and act like everybody else. How did I get my studio? Well, there was an earthquake, and I thought it was the end of the world. But then I saw a little light, and I said, oh, okay. They wanted to build a shopping center in my place. It took them forever to make a decision because the city council was holding it up. And I said, just buy my land and give me the money so I can go somewhere else. And I kept telling my politician, and he said, oh, can you wait a little longer? And I said, no, we can't. And so then finally one said to me at a city council meeting, well, if you're not happy, why don't you sue the city? He said, that's what everybody else does. They get busloads of people.
Yeah.
Busloads of people. They come down to City Hall and they get what they want. So I said, oh, that's a good idea. Let me try it. So we did. And we won. And we got the money for our land. It took a little while, but we got it. And so it's the whole thing was the idea that I had to think about getting busloads of people to come down to City Hall to come and talk about our value, to talk about our worth. We had to get letters from Washington, D.C., from Congresswoman Maxine Waters, any and everybody that you know. One other critic told me a long time ago at a meeting in the old days, and Betty Impey was here, and they would do the similar types of workshops. And she said to me, let them all know what you do. And I didn't do that for a long time. And I said, okay, what she meant was, send a letter to every city council person whenever you're doing something, whether they come or not. So I started doing that. And then when I would go to these councilmen and to different things, like show up, you have to show up. When you know and you have the time, you have to show up. And I would say, hi, I'm Lula Washington. And he said, oh, yes. I saw something that came across my desk. You're a dancer or something. Yeah, yes. You have to do that. We have to get that voice.
I know you've got a big stack of questions in there, but I want to jump in here with a thought, because I think what Angela was trying to get at is, how do we leverage the tremendous commercial success of a show that generates, you know, tens of millions of viewers in order to mobilize those folks as advocates for the arts, I think was your point. And I think what's really important here is, despite the lack of common language that we think we all have the same passion, came from the same place of passion and purpose, and we need to find better ways for the for-profit and non-profit sides of our dance communities to work together effectively to move forward on common objectives.
And don't forget, we did mobilize it by me going to Congress and getting us National Dance Day. We mobilized it by getting the Lincoln Center, the Music Center here in LA, and the Kennedy Center all doing National Dance Day. So it is being used, that leverage, but it's not easy. And Congress don't really listen.
It takes so much to accomplish what Lula has accomplished, what Nigel has accomplished. I tried. I went downtown. I tried it all. You need to write up a grant. Me? Write up a grant? holy smoke, well, you need to pay someone who will write it up. Finally, I just went to all the producers that I knew on television and finally got the lockers on television. But I was trying to get grants, and I was just beating my head against a stone wall. It was really, really rough. Rough.
What's your next question?
After training my daughter as a dancer, this doesn't have a name on it, she has grown into a beautiful dancer who recently graduated from NYU Tisch with a BFA in dance. Now she says she has graduated with a degree in unemployment. She's an artist, but how can she get a job as an artistic dancer? She's not in favor of dancing on Broadway or cruise ship, but is this the only way a dancer today can make a living? Thank
does
you.
She want to join a company? What does she want to do? Has she auditioned for companies?
What?
I don't know if we can do a back and forth thing unless
she's just getting started and she doesn't really know where to go. Is that the gist of it? Any help there, anybody?
When I started out, there weren't even agents, so she just should keep trying. That's all you can do.
Okay. Next question.
Sorry. No. I'm sorry.
Try again.
You just keep going out there and you keep auditioning. And if you're good enough, somebody will hire you.
Every single dancer auditions. And even when they work for the same choreographer for 10 years, that choreographer still gets them to audition for them.
Yes, it's called work and persistent. Work and persistent and not giving up.
But there are a lot of resources for her right now that we didn't have. You have the internet. So there are lots of ways to search for the ideal company that you might want that may not be here. So you need to, she would need to start, using those resources as well. There are auditions all across the United States for people looking for dancers. But the question is, she has to discover what kind of dancer she really wants to be and who she really wants to be with. And start doing it. That's a long process. It's a long journey. And then once she gets on that path, everyone that she goes to is going to have their own process for how they initiate people or find the people. And the question is, she has to be ready. But ready goes back to getting your technique together, getting your training together, being prepared mentally, physically, and have a little extra cash.
Next. This is talking about the impact of the new So You Think You Can Dance format of stage versus street. How do you think this will influence dance for the next generation?
The reason we did this was because we were lucky to get back Fox, who were not going to recommission the show. They wanted changes, and I wanted to keep the integrity of the program. And at the same time, I really love the creativity of street dancers. They may not be trained, but and when you put a piece of music on and you ask them to dance, they generally are far more creative than the trained dancers that just literally regurgitate steps. And so I'm very much behind street kids, but constantly punch them and kick their ass and say, you get some training. And the hardest thing for street dancers is to learn choreography. Yeah. Even in their own styles, the brain does not work like that. So you're constantly getting them to do it. And the beauty of it is across the weeks, you can see their journey. And it is a journey. And I say, don't focus on the end of it. Focus on the journey, because you'll learn far more that way. Is it working? I get so many complaints. Nobody likes change. I'm 100% change every single year. Change. Unless you're changing, you're not moving forward. You're stagnating, and we can't afford to do that. I think what is happening now is that the street kids are realizing that they have to have technique, and the kids with technique realizing they've got to be more creative with that technique. So we are finding a super dancer now. It really is. It's been phenomenal. The last 4 to 5 years. You know, I used to rush to see Nureyev do 4 or 5 pirouettes, and I go, wow, he did 4 pirouettes. I'd do 2, stumble over somewhere. And my warm-up was sitting on a radiator with a scotch. and I'd be amazed. These kids are doing 14 and 15 pirouettes now. It's only gravity that's stopping them. The technique, when they've got technique nowadays, it's remarkable. And the more diverse, and certainly with things like Project Plie, where we're actually getting dancers of color in, and not just dancers, but administrators, because there's so much you know, you can feel isolated. If you are a black dancer in a white company, no matter how much you're enjoying it, you feel isolated. And they can't afford to do that because they'll just leave the company. And we need to get that diversity in companies because that's going to bring a diverse audience in as well. And we're losing what I call the blue rinse brigade. The older generation is sort of dying off. Wow. And, you know, you're seeing red seats there now in theaters, and people are saying, oh, it's all right, they're subscribers. They might not be. They're dead. Right. They've gone. People, wake up.
Oh, gosh. That's very funny. This is from Nicole Green, a dance educator to Laura Zucker. What resources can I use to promote more arts awareness and appreciation on my high school campus? My students do rallies, halftime shows, dance concerts, etc. But when it comes to classes getting funding, my class is at the bottom of the totem pole. What else can I do to create more awareness?
What school district are we talking?
I'm in Linwood Unified.
Linwood Unified. I'm not sure, but I think that Linwood is an Arts for All district. Thank you, Talia. And Charles, which means that your school board has adopted a policy for arts education and a plan, which you can find on our website. And it may be time to go with a copy of the plan to your principal and say, wow, really excited about this. How can I help implement it?
This is from Melina. What is your anybody who wants to take it? What is your perspective on resolving the issue of being a good teacher versus how many YouTube hits or Instagram followers you are getting for getting a teaching job at a major LA dance studio?
What was
the beginning? So, what's your perspective on resolving the issue that apparently sounds to me as though, you know, you can be a good teacher or you have a lot of Instagram followers and they may choose the Instagram follower to do the teaching rather than the good teacher.
That's what she was saying.
Yeah.
Right. And
so
I think
another question came in, so I'm going to add on to that.
Okay.
Which was, what can we do about that? So people who are.
Well, it's the reality of today.
Here's the thing. I think that there are genuinely some. I don't even really want to call them choreographers. Amazing dancers that are now teaching, but it's a different time. So I think in their mind, you have to decide: are you there to educate? Are you there to teach? Are you there to actually develop the next generation of students, of teachers, of choreographers, or are you there? Which is the biggest problem we have right now is. Hey, I'm going to teach a master class because I can feel it, and then I can tell all my students, listen, I'm going to perform. If you guys want to pull your phones out, you can tape me while I perform, and then after class, why don't you tag this on Facebook? So they're really there for themselves.
Wow.
Yeah, this is more often than not, unfortunately. But you know, it doesn't mean that it needs to stay there. I think just saying it and us as a community, we need to look at each other and kind of, you know, checks and balances. Like, what am I doing? What music am I playing? What musical content am I saying in my choreography? And is it appropriate for the age that's in my class? Am I here as an educator? And I think, like I said earlier, I wish more studio owners were like Lula, but unfortunately that's not the case. So I would like to suggest that maybe we can go to some of these big time studios that are here in LA and just, if you know, I'll write the constitution of etiquette because it is not being taught, and just have it on your front door, and make sure, stick around after, don't go home at 6 o'clock when the adults are coming in or when the 12-year-olds are sneaking into the adult classes and you're not there to see what's going on at your studio. Stick around like Lula did and say, what music are they playing? Why is there an 11-year-old in there with a bunch of adults at a dance studio? Now, if you're a convention owner and you're trying to do your own thing, the same thing. Why are we rewarding bad behavior in dance at these dance conventions? Everyone's going home with a trophy But what are they winning that trophy for, and what is it saying to them about dance? And what are we raising? I think, you know, you ask, like, what can we do? We can just keep the conversation going, and we can, I think, I don't want to necessarily say put pressure on these studios, but we need to bring the awareness that this isn't okay, and we're not standing behind it. We want better educators in our dance studios.
Yeah, but are they actually telling these, I don't believe in the competitions and stuff anyway. So when they're going, when like we get kids to say, oh, my daughter has 50 trophies, and she's been in a competition school, but she doesn't know a demi-plie. Exactly. She doesn't know a port-de-bras. And so she's going back to a beginning class. So that's hard news. But at what point will they find out this information that this is unacceptable for the lingerie to be on the stage? Who's telling them that? If you're not applying the pressure, it's not. The squeakiest wheel gets the oil. Somebody told me that. I don't know what that means. So if we're not squeaking, we're not squeaking enough about it to them, how are they actually going to understand that this is inappropriate? And who is the person that's going to do that? Maybe you should put the Ten Commandments of that maybe on the webpage or someplace. I don't know. Maybe we tweet it that this is unacceptable for little girls to be in lingerie or to be hearing trashy music. I just don't allow it. You know, if you have common sense and you care about the students, then you should not allow it. But it's, the problem is they're finding young people that have no concept.
Well, it's also financially based. So the studio owner is not going to turn away anybody who wants to take a class, no matter if it's appropriate for them or not, as long as the parents are allowing.
If it's trashy music, I don't have it, and I just tell their parents, no, I'm sorry.
And like I said, I wish there were more of you out there or more that cared about it. But this is really the snowball that has been rolling for a while, and it does revolve around social media. It does revolve around hits. It does revolve around money at the end of the day.
So I that was news to me that in a sense teaching is being monetized by the sort of social media aspects. The internet, I what I'm hearing here, you know, when you see dance live, one thing I think you really must do is promise yourself to go see dancers live. Because, you know, I am the first one to say how much I appreciate So You Think You Can Dance and deeply revere and value it. But 1.5 minutes of sustained dance is different than a 20-minute piece. Mm-hmm. And when you see these great dancers that you've talked about, they change, Nureyev changes your life because he changes the ions in the air. That's the same thing with Catherine Dunham. And you can't get it. I am sorry, you cannot get it off of television. You can't get it off of this. You can't. You can get something else off of that. And I'm not saying that's bad, but there is a spiritual aspect to dance that has to do with what is invisible. And the invisibility is about the space in which it happens. This space around is part of the dance. On a frame, in a television set, or in a movie, it is contained in a different kind of way. And so you dance differently. So I think partly that this literacy of dance that we're really talking about is I feel that when Toni goes in and she sees these salsa dancers who blow her away, that's live dance. That's in front of you. That's part of that. And if some of these kids, instead of just getting the information off of small bits and thinking that, you know, that I think that there's a disconnect.
You know that this Saturday, Special Olympics opens here in Los Angeles. And that week on the Friday, for the first time ever, Special Olympics are introducing dance into the games. I was asked to put together a competition for them, and we're doing it at Wallace Annenberg. There are tickets available, I'm sure. That's the 29th. But the one thing I would like to say is the Dizzy Feet Foundation Gala is on at the Club Nokia on the 1st of August. And there are only 900 seats to be bought. And we've been advertising it now for over a month. And I think we've sold 168.
Oh, my God. It's always packed.
It's because we give the tickets away to all the kids and everything. But anything that you can do, please, to get people to Club Nokia on the 1st of August. It's a fantastic night. Lula Washington's company is going to be there. Body Traffic's going to be there. Fabrice Calmel's from Joffrey's going to be there.
God, all of
this. All of these So You Think You Can Dance All Stars are going to be there. It's a fantastic evening and full of all forms of dance. So if you can, please tell everybody.
Thank you. Thank you. Putting your body behind it. It's worth the effort. There was another question to somebody, since you mentioned Dizzy Feet, wants to know, is there a Los Angeles office he or she would like to work there?
Oh, how lovely. We're very, very small. We've got a secretary and we've got a director, and that's it. We are totally web-based. The only time we really get any money is from the gala. We immediately give that straight back to community projects. So we work very tightly. Nobody gets paid. I'm sure we would love help on the day. And the biggest help you can do is go to the website. There's a little thing on it called Clickly, and it asks you to donate $10.
Oh, if everybody did, think what would happen.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And we give between $5,000 and $10,000 scholarships away.
How can we build on the success of National Dance Day to bring the joy of dance to broader audiences, particularly since we won't have So You Think You Can Dance programs that goes into millions of... that doesn't make any sense. But
from my point of view, I think we're going to learn more and more of the benefits of dance. We know that it staves off
dementia.
We know... seriously, that was... I couldn't remember for a minute.
No! You
don't need to touch that.
What's my name? Tina. I just think we'll see the benefits of it. They're starting to break up as well, you know, the brain and the different hemispheres and how dance assists in learning for everything and how much better. And I think it was the... a clinic in New York found out that the next best thing to dance was people who do crossword puzzles. And that was it. No sport, no nothing else. It was crossword puzzles, and that was something like it, that helped 46%. 70-odd percent was through ballroom dancing, which was very interesting.
Wow.
Also, you know, perhaps if we kind of look at it as how we connect to other activities, such as baseball, hockey, basketball, swimming. Keep making those types of connections to the sports world. Because dance, I mean, when they're jumping, they do plié. It's the only way they can get up there to do that. You know, when they fall, some of them, they hurt themselves, but if they took dance class, they would fall better. seriously. So connecting the dots, connecting those dots becomes very important. And that's one of the things when I do my educational programs, when I work with the young students, is I immediately start connecting dance to a sport activities that they know. And so they all know baseball, they all know hockey, and then I teach them some of the things that we have in common. We plie. When we're sitting, we're actually in a plie. Our knees are bent. So I try to connect it that way. So if we can connect to some of the bigger sports activities, I mean, I went to the circus even, and I saw some things. People want to be brought into what we do. And a lot of times when they go to see dance or dance concerts, they're not moved or brought into what we do, particularly what people tell me from my community. They say it's dull or it's boring or whatever. And I always say, go with open mind. Go to see what you can get. Go with no expectations and let it reveal itself to you. So how you see it and what will make you want to go back to it. So I want to come back to see the work. I want people to want to be moved and touched and motivated.
We are pack animals.
So we need to do that.
We like
we need to do that.
Truth, yeah.
So if I do a concert and you see a ball come by and everybody get to hit it, oh, they're having fun. I mean, I haven't done that yet. I might try it at one concert. But
you get thrown out at the Dodgers if you do that.
Oh, no, not the Dodgers. I mean at the theater. In the theater. I mean, because if you can go to the circus and they're in clothes and they're doing it and they're, hey. I mean, but at the end, I had so much fun.
I never thought I would experience that at a concert. Or maybe if we could all afford to give them some free wine or something, some soda for the kids. You know, something. We don't have the little gimmicks. You know, when I go to these football games and stuff, you see they have lots of gimmicks that people get excited.
Kiss cams.
People get excited about being there. They have the roaming cameras where they see you kiss. They have all kinds of things, you know, but we just have what we have when we have it.
And we have it. We have it today. We had it all day long. We have it this evening. Thank you so much, every single one of you. Thank you, all of you. This was wonderful. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.